saving. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I can be free and I can be whole and I can tell everyone I know. You thought I was worth it. You cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So I can be free. So I can be whole. And I can tell everyone. You thought I was.
Came
and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. You cleaned me up inside. You thought I was dying for. You thought I was to die for. You thought I was to die for, die for. Hallelujah. He thought I was to die for. You came and changed my life just so I can be free. Hallelujah. To the God who changed my life. I'll forever praise you. You deserve it, Lord. You thought I was to die for. He sacrificed his life so I can be free.
First Peter chapter 4, just one verse. It's our theme for this year. First Peter chapter 4, verse number 10. Bow with me in a word of prayer. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. There's none like you. From everlasting to everlasting, you are God. We think of you for who you are. We thank you for the things that you have done. Thank you for for being able to see this brand new year. This first Sunday, first observation of your ordinance, first time fellowshipping with you and one with another. It's preaching time, and much is at stake. It's the same old place, same old prayer. Please preside over the preaching with precision, with passion, and with power. You know the frailty of our frame and fragility of our form. So as again, God, we ask that you pardon us of our guilt, protect us with your goodness, divide for us with your grace, persuade us with your gospel, and pour out your gift. Make your word believable and receivable. Make your people receptive as well as responsive to your word. Holy Spirit, this is your time to have your way, to do your thing. Think with my mind and speak with my mouth. You are the real preacher. Convince, convict, and convert into the conformity of Christ. Add into the body of Christ such as should be saved. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Thank you and amen. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse number 10. There you'll find these words quoted for your listening as they have been translated in the New International Version. Each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. Each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. Just for a little while, again, I want to talk on our theme for this year, faithfully growing in God's grace. Faithfully growing in God's grace. Like many of us, I can recall a time growing up. Parents would take us to the department store, to the mall, to buy us some new clothing. It irritated me for most of the times when new clothing was purchased, it was too large. The ideology behind the purchase was that they wanted the clothes to last for a great deal of time. And even though we may have complained about the clothes being too large, they were purchased oversized on purpose with the thought that you'll one day grow into them. Never really understood that, as many of you had to endure that particular problem growing up. Oversized clothes were purchased for you, but you always heard the same answer: you'll grow into it. Our brothers and sisters, our spiritual clothes or our church clothes, they come oversized. The gifts that God gives us by way of his grace, they don't fit at the front. When we first adorn them, we have to become adjusted to them without alterations. We just have to keep living, keep doing those things that develop us so that we will grow into them. We didn't have to do anything to grow into them. Just keep on eating, exercising, and sleeping, and getting rest, and all of that stuff. And eventually, you didn't have to roll up the cuffs of the pants anymore. Those legs got a little longer. Those feet got a little wider, and you begin to fit those clothes that were at one time frumpy, embarrassing, and uncomfortable. Our brothers and sisters, when we first get saved, or when we start to come into the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, it's a little uncomfortable. It's a little awkward at times, and certain things don't feel like they are a good fit. But if we keep on doing those things that help us to develop, eventually we'll find our perfect fit in the church clothes that God gives us according to the gifts of his grace. First Peter is a great book. It's a book that he wrote to five cities in Asia Minor to advise them about spiritual growth, living for God and Jesus Christ, exercising their gifts in this newfound faith, avoiding false teachers, and all of that. And then first nine verses, he strophes through some admonitions about suffering, about sacrifice, about selfishness, about slanderers, spirituality, thinking soberly, and then some heartfelt sentiments, one with another, who were going through. And he wanted them to know that they were gifted by God. And God gives everyone gifts whereby they can serve him in the capacity that God seeks to, for them to serve in the body of Christ. And so there are timeless truths that are trapped within the treasury of this text that are tailored to teach us that since we have experienced grace that saves, we are expected to explore grace to serve. I think I need to say that again. Since we've already experienced grace that saves, we are expected to explore grace to serve. Yes, my brothers and sisters, salvation is free. God took care of all of that, did all the heavy lifting, fulfilled in Jesus Christ everything that was necessary to be done for our salvation. By grace, we are saved through faith, not of works, lest any should boast. It is the gift of God. So essentially, salvation is free, but rewards cost. Rewards cost. And we do not receive rewards other than serving in the body of Christ. Salvation is unmerited, but rewards are merited. Just like school, grades are earned, scholarships are earned. Like in the workplace, raises are earned, promotions are earned. It's merit-based. And God gives us the same kind of grace, even more so, beyond our salvation, to get us to serve him. But God doesn't put ads in the paper. He does not advertise in the classifieds. He does not post listings on employment websites when it comes to serving in the body of Christ. What he does is he speaks with that still small voice as he has for generations to get people to motivated to do what he's required of them to do based on how he's gifted them to do it in the body of Christ. So the sermonic question for today for all of us is, are we just living on purpose or are we living in purpose? That's something that we really must consider. Living on purpose is basically doing what you want to do, the way you want to do it, how you want to do it, who you want to do it with, where you want to do it. All of those adverbials. But living in purpose is waking up every day with a clear sense of what you're placed on this earth for. And everybody doesn't have that, my brothers and sisters. And for those of you that do, that's a blessing a lot of times that we take for granted, to understand and have a clear sense of the purpose of why God placed us here on this earth. Now, God doesn't frown upon you getting an education, getting a good job, having a good, fruitful and lucrative career, and providing nice things for yourself and your family. No, he doesn't. Doesn't despise that at all. In fact, if you read through Proverbs, there's passage after passage that God talks downward, or he speaks against laziness and slothfulness. He always promotes being industrious. He always promotes being busy and trying to attain some kind of success as far as taking care of oneself is. But when it comes to the work of the ministry, That's what we are saved for. And that's why in Ephesians chapter 6, it says, he gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, and for the edifying of the body of Christ. And God wants us to grow in our faith to a place whereby we are eager to serve him on any given hand, not necessarily doing the things that we prefer to do, as is the custom of some. Because some people can only get actively engaged in doing what they prefer to do. But if you really study the Bible, look at some of the characters that God has used from Genesis on through into the New Testament. Most of them, God called them out of places of comfort into doing something that was altogether foreign and unfamiliar for them, so that he could use them based on how he made them. Because he knows the strands on all of our heads, strands of hair on our heads. He knows us better than we know ourselves. And he has equipped us or prepackaged us in order to fulfill the calling that he has placed upon us. And the reason sometimes we get frustrated in ministry work is because we're trying to satisfy another saint or another servant. And we have not considered what the sovereign or what the Savior wants. And so in our approach to this year, one of the resolutions that we should make with ourselves is to ask God, where am I best suited for you to use me? You already know that coming to church is fine. We're grateful that you attend the worship services regularly. But even more than that, there is a place for you in the body of Christ so that you can do what God wants you to do, so that you'll have a great reward. And that great reward, brothers and sisters, is not as arduous as those servant tasks and those saint tasks, because those servant tasks and those saint tasks can wear us down. They can be overwhelming at times. But Jesus in a parable taught that if you're just faithful over a few things, I'll make you ruler over many, and you can enter into the joy of the Lord, and he will give you that optimum commencement address. Well done, good and faithful servant. Charles Kingsley put it this way: we act as though grace, as though comfort and luxury were the chief requirements of life, when all that we need to make us really happy is something to be enthusiastic about. That's a person who lives in purpose. They wake up every day with something they're enthused about, something they're excited about, something that they look forward to fulfilling or accomplishing every time, not just doing the things that make us comfortable. Because in order to get some things that we don't have or we've never had, we have to do some things that we've never done. And yes, there are challenges, but even through the challenges, God gives us what we need, and he gives us who we need in order to meet the challenges of the day. Evangelist Billy Sunday put it like this: more men fail through lack of purpose than lack of talent. It's not that we don't have the talents. Again, God has already pre-equipped us, pre-packaged us with what we need to be successful. Thing that we need to focus on, brothers and sisters, is purpose. What on earth am I here for? That ought to be in your prayer repertoire if it has not been answered already. God, how can I be used to bring your name glory? And if it goes beyond the church, the essentials of having a worship service or some kind of event in the house of the Lord, it goes on beyond those doors, because we enter into the sanctuary to worship, but we depart out of the sanctuary to serve. And there are many, many ways that God is trying to use you, my brother, you, my sister, out in the community, in the workplace, in your neighborhood, among your civic groups and your neighbors and your friends and constituents and all of that, that like, even in your travels and at leisure, he's trying to use you or fulfill the purpose that he's placed you here on this earth for. And even though some of us have come about by unconventional circumstances, God allowed us to be here so that we can fulfill his will. And there, nobody's an accident. Nope. I don't care what mom said. I don't care what dad said. Nobody's an accident. You are here on purpose. God knew you were going to be here before mom and dad even ever met. And so, since we are all here, why don't we allow God to get the greatest use out of all of us? There are two things that I see in the text. First of all, if we're going to faithfully grow in God's grace, we're going to do so by graciously releasing to others. Graciously releasing to others. Each one should use whatever gift he or she has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various form. That's what we're here for, to serve others. That's really the hallmark of how you serve God. You serve God through serving others. Whenever somebody prayed about, Lord, use me, whenever God interrupted somebody's life, confronted somebody, it always had something to do with somebody else. Moses was chilling on the backside of the Midian Mountains, being a shepherd. He had one of those son-in-law jobs in a prosperous industry. And so as he was in that valley, he saw in the mountains the lights flickering and shining. Now, it wasn't unusual because people started fires all the time to light their way or to warm themselves. But that same fire on that bush was burning by the end of the day. And he resolved within himself, by now this bush should have burned up. It should have been consumed. He said, I got to go see what this is all about. And it is from there that God, out of the burning bush, called out to him, telling him what he wanted him to do for others, right? He said, I want you to go back to Egypt, place where you ran off from. You got to go back there, and I want you to tell Pharaoh to let my people go. He gave Moses a hard job, and Moses haggled him like he was buying a used car, trying to get out of it. Even in modern translation, the text says, Lord, please, find somebody else to do it. And that's what we feel sometimes. Have you ever been there? Lord, please find somebody else to do this. You're comfortable. You're chilling and doing what you're doing. You don't have any problems and any of that. And you know that doing something for others is going to breed a lot of contempt. Moses knew where he was. He knew those Israelites and he knew those Egyptians, but yet and still, God had reminded him that he had equipped him with everything that he needed, and even the things that he did not have, God is able to add into your life. God, my brothers and sisters, is the one who provides us with the resources necessary to get the job done. You're probably always asking yourself, why do you always got to put out the fires? Because God gave you the hose. Probably asking yourself, why does God have me sweeping up messes? Because he gave you the broom. Amen, somebody. whatever it is within us, we always find ourselves doing that thing God wants us to do because he prepackaged us. He equipped us. I can't say that enough to get that particular job done. This text excludes no one from service. You can't pull the gender card. You can't pull the age card. You can't pull the education or the economic card. It says each one should use whatever gift he or she has received to serve others. All of us in here have at least one gift. At least one gift. And you got to ask yourself, are you using that gift for yourself, or are you using it for the glory of God? Or even worse, is that gift laying dormant within? It's inactive because you refuse to use it for either God or self. In either case, my brothers and sisters, we've got to identify that thing which God has given us so that we can use it. This is a command, as the scripture admonishes us to use it. And not for ourselves, but for others. Oftentimes you hear me saying about certain individuals when I'm either introducing or presenting them in one form or another, for a preacher, a singer, whoever, I'm telling you that they lend their gifts to the body of Christ. They realize that their gifts are not their own. Their gifts are not their own. They're God-given, and God expects to get a return on his investment. Any of you that have made any kind of investment in anything, your 401k, your pension plan, deferred compensation, your property, income property or otherwise, your business, you expect to get a return out of that. When you put something into something, you want to see something come out of it, right? You don't want it squandered, of course. You don't want it to lay dormant, but you want to use it. That's why God saved you. I keep on telling you all the time, it's just simple wisdom. Why do you save anything at all? So you can use it later on, right? And so that's why we're saved, so that God can use us whenever he feels necessary for it to use us. So each one of us should use whatever gifts. And gifts vary from person to person. And in most instances, we find a person operating out of their gift. We got to learn in the body of Christ how to stay in our lane. Amen, somebody. Stay in our lane. One of the first toys that you perhaps played with was one of those developmental toys. It was just a board with some shapes cut into it, and then there were little different colored pegs or pieces that were the exact shape of the cutouts in the board, right? And you learned how to develop, and your parent or your loved one tried to guide you into development and try to help you to put the right piece into the right hole, right? And you were underdeveloped, you were learning the game and the ins and outs of this board. It might as well have been rocket science to you when you were first introduced. And many of us tried to take that moon, crescent moon-shaped peg and ram it in a star hole. I know it's in space. You close. It looks like it's from space, but it didn't work. And you kept trying to force it in. And when you try to force something where it doesn't go, it's going to break. Or it's not going to fit right if you get it in, if you jam it in there. It's not going to fit the way that it's supposed to. And eventually, that's going to cause a problem. What we got to learn in the body of Christ is stop forcing things in Jesus' name. Because oftentimes, listen to me, in church, we're doing right the wrong way. Amen. There's a such thing as doing right the wrong way. God wants us to be efficient as well as effective, doing things in the right way so that the best possible outcome is going on in that immediate environment or that surrounding or that person or that ministry. And here's another thing that we do in the body of Christ. Some things that God wants us to do is temporary. But because it's church, we scared to stop something that's telling you, I'm dead. It's on life support, and we keep trying to pump life into it. And it's telling you, it's time to stop doing that. It's irrelevant. We can move on to something else. Take that energy, take that time, take those resources, and apply them into something that's more relevant and more meaningful. And so we do this by being ever prayerful and ever conscious of those gifts that we have received. Some of us have a gift of just prayer. You don't need a platform or a podium or a pulpit to pray for anybody. All the people on the prayer list, it's nothing more than a visit or even simpler, a phone call. The Lord put you on my mind to pray for you. And oftentimes, just a small, short prayer encourages a person and even makes them feel better, because we can get through just about anything, saints, when we know that we have the right kind of support system around us. So all the time, it's not the treatment. All the time, it's not the medication. It's the support system that we have around us to help us get through whatever's going on in our life. That word gift in verse number 10, it really means that which is freely given and generously. God has given all of us gifts, again, for free, and he's given them to us generously. He isn't like the cafeteria line where they give you that little scoop, and you looking at them and like on with your tray, you're like, give me some more. No, God gives you a generous portion. He always does things with a leftover mentality, a cup running over mentality. He always does things exceedingly and abundantly above all we can ask, think, or imagine. He always operates beyond our expectations. That's why we are blessed beyond capacity. And so when he gives these gifts, we don't have to worry about not having enough giftedness to go around. Because he gives you the gift, and that gift lasts as long as it is needed. He'll give you that gift to be able to serve not just dozens, but hundreds of those you encounter in your life, if you allow him to do it. Because I'm always telling you something simple that sometimes we tend to forget. If we are just willing, God will make us able. But in that willingness, we got to take a look at some things. I am willing, and so I will sacrifice right here. I'm willing, and so I will give of my time over here. I'm willing, so I will spend these resources instead of on something trivial that I'm going to use for myself to impress people that it's not going to like me anyway. I could use this for the glory of God. Because last time I checked, when I give to me, I don't get the return I get when I give to God. Because we can't beat God giving, no matter how we try. And that's just not about money. That's just not about compensation or consideration. That's about our time. That's about our talents. We can't beat God giving. And the more we do something, the better we become at it. Am I right? Yeah. Practice still makes perfect. The more we do something, the better we become at it. God is trying to use somebody in here today to write the book on this, that, and the other. All right. Whatever that particular thing is. He's trying to get you to, but he's got to get you doing it to the fullest of your ability and potential before you can encourage others to do it as well. There are lots of people in many different professions that when they walk out of their church on any given Sunday or scheduled day of worship, that they go off into that thing which they look forward to every day of doing it because it gives God glory. At work, some of us hate going to work. Clock goes off. It hits snooze as many time as the law allows. Then we finally get up, and we take forever getting ready. And we finally get there because we don't want to encounter those sour coworkers, or maybe we've got a horrible boss or manager or something like that, but we get there, and some of us, we don't like our place of employment. Well, I learned this a long time. I had a manager by the name of Elizabeth Jackson. She said it like this, something simple. You're at work too long in the day to be miserable. Amen, somebody. We think about, well, I got bills to pay. I got children to take care of. I got needs to get met. Well, you should be doing something that you love to do, or it's going to frustrate you all the more. Because, again, those things that gratify ourselves, a lot of times they are gratifying on the back end, but in the process, the means don't justify the ends. And so when it comes to God, when it's that good fit, when it's that thing that he's designed you to do, you won't receive those same frustrations. You'll feel like Paul felt when he talked to the Galatians, saying that you won't get weary in your well-doing because you know that you're going to reap from what you're doing if you're persistent, if you're consistent. And so here, Peter is pretty much saying the same thing. He says, use whatever those gifts that God has given you to serve others. Amen. And you know when it's being done for the sake of others. They won't take nothing from it. They don't solicit anything. They don't, you know, there's no back end deal or anything. They just do it. And they do it from the heart. Paul says it like this in Ephesians 4:7. He says, but grace was given to each of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Grace, first of all, has been given to each of us. It's been measured out to each and every one of us based on your capacity to receive as well as release. Some only got a small container in which to receive. And you'll serve out small doses when you release. Some have large containers, and they receive a lot of giftedness from God, and then they have a lot of it to pour out as well. But God has enough grace and enough gifts to go around so that you can graciously release to others. Each one should use whatever gift received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. What else is there? Not only do we graciously release to others, but we also gracefully relate to others. That's how we faithfully grow in God's grace, by gracefully relating to others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. There's the problem right there. Faithfulness. Faithfulness. It says in the next clause, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. God requires of all stewards, and we're all stewards, we manage over stuff. It's all God's by ownership. Yes, you pay the note on the car. Yes, you keep the tags registered. Yes, you've got insurance on it. Yes, you perform on the maintenance on it. Yes, you drive it. Yes, you fill it up with gas. Yes, you put the windshield washer fluid in the car, but I'm sorry to be the one to tell you, it's not your car. I know the title says, has your name and your address on it and other designations and characters and information, but it's not your car. Amen, somebody. Proof of it that is really not your car is because you went somewhere and got it where it already was. Amen, somebody. You didn't know the manufacturer was even making that car in that color, the exterior, the interior, with those features at all until the day you decided, hey, I need a car, and I'm going to go get one. And then your eyes fell upon that particular vehicle, and you signed the papers with God's hand. Amen. You put the money down from God's job that he gave his child the health and the strength to work all the 40, 60, 80 hours a week, whatever we do, and all that stuff. So it's all God's. And so if God wants you to go somewhere, he wants you to go in that car. Yes. Amen, somebody. Amen. But here's the thing I love about God is, you know, a lot of us with God need to quit while we're ahead. When we got to do for God, it's a problem. But a lot of times, God don't ask you to do nothing for a long time, and you've done all the stuff that you wanted to do. You've gone all the places in God's car that you wanted to go. And the one time he said, okay, I need you to go over here for a little while. The eyes start rolling, those lips start smacking then. Then we're being a poor steward of what God has given us. And so, therefore, we got to remind ourselves that God, I told you this a lot of times last year, is faithful to the faithful. Now, does that seem fair? Yes, it's fair. God is faithful to the faithful. Because Scripture says if you acknowledge him, he's fine with you. But if you disown him at times, he will disown you because he cannot disown himself, right? So God is faithful to the faithful. And if you have a willingness and desire to be faithful to God and to engage yourself into those things that bring him glory and honor through his name, he will be faithful to you in making sure that you get the job done time after time. You have what you need to get the job done time after time, who you need to get the job done time after time. But when we are more faithful to our own personal interests and our own pursuits and pleasures, that is when we're always struggling and trying to scrape and piece things together. It's always some drama. Because when you are faithful to God, it seems like things just fall in your lap. When you don't have any motive but to give God glory, to walk in your purpose, to fulfill your assignment, things just fall right in your lap. But when you're scurrying about killing yourself, it should make you reevaluate how you're doing things and the reason and the motive behind what you're doing. Each of us should use whatever gift he has to receive to serve others faithfully, administering God's grace in its various forms. That word for grace and that word for gift kind of have the same root word, charis and charisto. That is basically where we get our word charity from. We know what charity is. That is loving, giving, and doing things from the heart. That is extending even beyond ourselves. What? For somebody else. Charity isn't charity until you've done something. Commission sang a song back in the 80s, sometime back in the 90s, some time ago. They had a song that said, love isn't love until you've given it
away.
Because it really isn't. People don't know that you love them until you've done something. Right? You can say, I love you all day long. But unless you do something that that person can perceive as love, then Paul's saying we're just like a tinkling cymbal or a resounding gong. We're just making a bunch of noise. Bang, 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 bang. And nobody wants to hear that. Paul said another time to the church at Corinth, he says, you know, you gotta demonstrate a love people can see. Amen, somebody. See, we good at letting people hear it. But we need to do a better job of letting people see it. And we go around patting ourselves on our back. I love everybody. What are you doing for anybody? Most people that go around talking about I love everybody, they're the most selfish people that could ever walk the earth. And they're trying to convince themselves that they have all this love. But people that generally have love for other people, they ain't got they don't have to announce it. They don't have to write it in the sky. They don't have to program electronic marquee that says, I love everybody. You see their love based on their demonstrations, based on their acts of kindness, based on their sacrifice. And love, here's another McGeeism, that's what they like to call it. Love is hard work. I thought I would get at least 19 amens right there. Love is hard work. Man, because you love them, but you don't feel like it all the time. Amen, somebody. You may love them, but you don't feel like you should have to. It's people that you love and do things for, you know, they don't make it convenient. Talk back with me if you're in here. They don't make it convenient. When you got two nerves left, that's when they over here japping off a clown and a messing something up. Amen. You finally saved enough to do a little something for yourself. Like my mom used to say, I'm about to make myself a present. That means she's going to take that money and she's going to do something for herself. You get ready to make yourself a present and you like, it costs what? And how long did you know this? And you just now telling me it's got to be done tomorrow. That love is hard work. Love is hard work. Love takes a lot of tolerance. Amen, somebody. And a lot of times the person that's receiving the love don't know the Everest that you're climbing to do it. They just like, what? I gave some people a homework assignment. I told them to read Malachi. I said, Malachi speaks to your generation when I gave them this assignment. And they were like, what do you mean? I said, the people of Israel are like your generation, you know, with the apathy and, you know, sometimes the level of, you know, unconcern about certain things. You know, one of today's younger generation, you know, their thing is what? Basically telling them what, but they're like, what? You know, it's like they're not getting something. So I said, read Malachi. And in Malachi, the Israelites, their communication to God is one great big what? It's a series of questions that God uses Malachi to ask the Israel, when this, when was that? And the Israelites are like, what? When we didn't do that? What? When we didn't do that? What? And there was always an answer. God asks rhetorical questions. He's not quizzing you for information that he does not already have. They're always rhetorical questions. He just wants you to be aware of what he's aware of. That's what the questions are really about. So he asks you those questions so that you can know. And a lot of times, like the people of Israel in Malachi's time, we're like, what? God's trying to tell you what? He's trying to get you to be faithful in your engagements, as the church covenant says, and exemplary in all of your deportment. In other words, God wants you efficiently and effectively busy at those things that gratify him more so than ourselves. Being faithful is a hallmark. Amen. Because God blesses the faithfulness. One of my mentors told me years ago, and I hear it ringing true time again in my life's work and ministry, that faithfulness pays off every time. And a lot of times we think we're giving up stuff, and Jesus had to, he had to check Peter. He said, Peter, like, all right, pull Jesus to the side. He's like, we left everything and everybody, businesses, homes, and families and stuff like this. And you just told this fellow, you talk about this fellow up here talking about it's hard for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of heaven as it is for a camel to go through the eye of a needle. He said, we left everybody, so what's in it for us? What shall we have therefore? Jesus had to check him. He said, ain't none of you that left families and businesses and houses and land and all that stuff shall not receive twice as much and then some in the kingdom. See, God's goal is greater than our little goal, our little short time span. You know, God's is thinking eternally of us having everything that he promised and that he prescribed for us. He's not thinking in time. I keep on telling you, God doesn't have a watch. He's not, Gabriel, what time is it? He's not doing that. He doesn't have a calendar. He doesn't need one of those applications that remind him to do things. Remind you when I get to work, put your work address in it. So when you walk into work, the phone's ding. Letting you know, reminding you to do something when you get to work. God doesn't need that. He's omniscient. He's omnipresent. He's omnipotent. He knows all. He can do everything. He's everywhere. At the same time, he's trying to get you in on the grand scheme of what he's doing. He says, I've got so much more for you than you can comprehend. If you would just only get with the program. Stop fighting against it and get with the program. You wake up in the morning every day with a sense of purpose and you want to go to bed every night saying, I think I did with the best of my ability that which God wanted me to do. Simple things. It's a grace in its various forms. Grace comes in all kinds of different forms. Free stuff, free gifts from God. Opportunities to use those come in all kinds of forms. Helping a person struggling with a bag of groceries. Get them inside on a windy day, rainy day. That's grace in its various forms. Making sure that people who are not your BFFs and people who are not in your circle or your camp are doing all right. Just paying attention to the least of them, to the little things. No, you can't help every single body. But God reveals to you who he's trying to use you to help in your life. You may not know them deeply or intimately, but ever so casually. You may see them maybe only once in your life. Remember, I was sitting on a plane one day. A young lady was being deployed, going back to active duty. She had on, you know, battle dress uniforms and all that stuff. And so she's just shoulders jumping, boo-hooing. You know, trying to conceal it, trying to keep it quiet. So, you know, it's strange, but okay, I'm sitting there. I'm maybe
trying to offer some assistance. So I'm like some of you, you know, I don't like to approach strangers and stuff like that. I don't want nobody cussing me out just like you and looking me up and down, mind your business and all that stuff. You sit in your seat, I sit in my, I'm like you. You know, I have my apprehensions, but I still, you know, it bothered me. You know, she's just wiping her eyes and, you know, just crying. So I just asked her, you know, what's wrong? Is there, you know, not even knowing her, is there anything I can do for you? You need me to get the flight attendants? We hadn't even taken off good yet. She, you know, having a moment. So she began to explain to me that, you know, she's getting redeployed. She needs to do this. This is her income. This is her livelihood. This is how she takes care of the son that she's, small boy, that she's leaving behind. And so she was just having that moment, that separation anxiety. And so I began to talk to her and pray with her and encourage her and all that stuff. And she began to feel better and to look more positively. I haven't seen or heard from her. Again, just a casual passenger on the plane. But just the same, you know, God will use you in those small moments with people that you will never, ever even see again to make a difference. And it didn't cost me anything but time and getting over myself. And a lot of things, the reason why we can't bless somebody else, God can't use us for somebody else, because we can't get over ourselves. We get over ourselves and we overcome our little inhibitions and our apprehensions. That is when God can use us for his glory. We need to understand something. In this text and this verse alone, or if you read 1 Peter chapter 4 in its entirety, you can see that here there is a contributor mentality and not a consumer mentality. In the body of Christ, God is looking for more contributors than consumers. What's the difference? Thank you for the 5-6 eyebrows of protest. The consumers are the ones who want to be served all the time. Amen. Amen. Consumers are the ones that want something out of everything all of the time. They're looking for something. They're looking for an outcome, something for them. A contributor, you're just trying to get the job done. A contributor, you're just trying to make your space and time and geography a little bit better. A contributor, you're just trying to sow some seeds. And see, that's what's so remarkable when you hear Jesus talking about the sower this, the sower that. My hat is off to the sower, because the sower just plants seeds, walks away, trusting that God's going to do the rest. Now, the reaper, that's easy. You basically, again, reaping off of what somebody else has done. Your job is contingent upon somebody else's job. The person before you and God. Now you can do your job. But the sower's job, he's out in the front, he's sowing, and you're trusting God to do what he does, so that the one coming behind you can get their, and that can fulfill their obligations. But here it is, my brothers and sisters, God is looking for more sowers than reapers, more contributors than consumers. There's a certain church in Tennessee that on the marquee, you know, church marquees, they had the church name on them. They had the service times, worship time, Sunday school time, typically evening service. The address, of course, a nice logo. Some marquees always have a message of what's going on, maybe the sermon or the lesson of the week or some activities that's about to take place. But almost every church sign, almost every church marquee has the ministers of that church's name on it. But this particular church in Tennessee was a little different. It's like you ride by the church, there's nothing wrong with it. Mount Zion Church, Pastor John Jones, and you know, St. Paul Church, Pastor Michael Smith. There's nothing wrong with that. But this particular church, where it says minister, it said every member. Every member. Because really, biblical word for minister means is servant. And servant is something that all of us are required and commanded to do. Being of service is something that God is trying to get each of us to do, not let them do that. Or that's for them or this group over here. No, that's something that all of us can do. Because God is looking for a church where every member is a minister. Every saint is a servant. And every believer has a burden for doing that which God wants us to do. So you want to grow in God's grace, my advice to you is to start serving. It's already been said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these other things will be added unto you. And as I get ready to leave you now, we're about to serve the Lord's Supper. Be not dismayed. Whatever be tied, God will take care of you. It's 2016. You just missed your shout. You didn't know you would be here on the first Sunday of this new year. So beneath his wings of love abide, God will take care of you through every day, all the way. He will take care of you.